Before I get into this, how are your assignments going? So there's the general and then assignment three. Not bad. As always, like if you want to talk about anything you're working on, just send me an email or go onto Slack over the next fortnight. If you're having trouble with anything, just ask me. Be better to ask me than to. If you've got questions, that's what I'm here for. Cool. All right. All right. So this session, we're going to talk about what comes next. So some of this isn't that relevant for you guys right now, but it's good to talk about. Once you get to the point, say, we've gone through searching for a business idea, and a lot of the stuff in here is about, all right, what happens once you've got your business idea and you've got a bit of traction? What do you do? What are the things that will happen next? Big part of that is funding, and I'll talk about investment and funding at the end. But then at the start, I'm going to talk about some of the operational stuff. So what comes next? And there's this whole concept of scale and growth. Building a team, so hiring a team and culture, funding and investors. So what comes next? So essentially what we're talking about now is that Steve Blank, sorry, I just closed the door. Steve Blank talked about which some of the videos I showed at the start of the semester. He talked about customer development and then iterating and pivoting, once you learn a bit more about your customers and changing your product and then taking it back to them. Once you get to a point where you've got product market fit, the next step is actually company building. So what do you actually do to operationalize that and actually take, the product that you've got fit for to market at scale? So this is sort of like go to market, essentially what we're talking about, but going to market, previously we were talking about, all right, you're still searching for the way that you take this product to market. Once you get to that point and you've figured it all out, you actually need to scale this machine up. And so a lot of the stuff I'm going to go through today is different people talking about, we'll just watch a couple of videos on it, different people talking about those different components of scaling a business. I'll note that a lot of this stuff isn't, you don't have to weave into your investor memo, because a lot of it is sort of once maybe you are, if you were 2 years down the track from now working on your business idea, some of this stuff would come to town. So it's not as relevant, but it's good to have in the back of your mind. And it's interesting to think about how businesses make the transition between being a startup and being a real business. So the summary is, by now, basically, if you've been executing against your idea using that lean startup methodology, you'll have an idea of your market, scope and size, and also some traction in that market. You'll have an idea of your product suitability, and you probably have an MVP to prove out that. And you'd have a view on the costs and the revenue model side of the business. So on the business model canvas, you'd basically know, all right, I reckon it's going to cost me this much money to run this business at this scale, and I'm going to make this much money off this business at this scale. These are the next things. So how do you actually take that nascent sort of smaller business and make it very, very large? How do you scale those things once you've figured out all the component parts? How do you hire the right people into a startup, which is pretty hard? And some people would say it's the hardest thing to do. How do you build a culture around your company? And then how do you get funding? So I have heard advice around founders and founders and CEOs and things. One person said the role of a founder, or what the founder needs to do, is to set the vision, raise the money, build the initial product, and then set the execution standard. And then I would also add in there, like, you need to personally hire the team, bring on the people. Cool. So scale and growth. This guy is the former operations officer. This from this video, chief operations officer at Square. Square is a mobile payments business, which I believe was also co-founded by the former CTO of Twitter. So it's a pretty interesting company. If you've ever seen it, if you've ever been at a bar and someone's got like a little box plugged into their phone, you ever seen that? They're really cool, actually. Like, it's basically you just plug something into your phone and then you can take credit card payments with it. They use them at Apple stores quite a lot. So if you're ever in an Apple store, you don't go to a cashier, you just pay with the person in front of you. So growth and scale in the context of this means you can make the jump between searching for a business model, which is primarily, you know, a creative process with scientific elements on top, which is the lean startup methodology, you know, test, build, measure, learn, that whole feedback loop. And then you need to transition at this point to executing against the business model, which means you've got to be rigorous, super organized, and relentless in terms of your pursuit of growth. And he talks a little bit about some of those things. So there's another video on this down the bottom here, which you can watch in your own time if you like, but we'll watch, this one. If I can ever get to it.
So I've watched some of the prior classes, and I would assume that you've already sort of hired a bunch of relentlessly resourceful people, that you built a product that at least some people love, and you probably raised some capital.
So I'll watch about 10 minutes, 15 minutes of this, and then move on to the next one.
Now you got to forge a company. And I'd actually argue forging a company is much more difficult than forging a product. Basic reason is people are irrational. So you probably all know this. Either your parents, your significant other, your brother or sister, your teacher, somebody in your life is irrational. Building a company is basically taking all the irrational people you know, putting them in one building, and then living with them 12 hours a day at least. So it's very challenging. Now, there's techniques for coping with that, and some people get good at it and some people don't, but that's really what operating is about. So basically what you're doing when you build a company is you're building an engine. And at first you have a drawing, literally on a whiteboard, and you're architecting it, and it looks very conceptually clean and beautiful and pretty. But when you start actually translating it to practice, you actually, it looks more like this, and you're holding it together with duct tape. And it takes a lot of heroic efforts of people to actually hold it together. That's why people work 80, 100 hours a week, is that heroic efforts is actually necessary to keep this thing together because you don't actually yet have polished metal in place. Eventually, you want to construct a high-performance machine, a machine that actually almost nobody really has to worry about every hour, every minute. And, you know, as we used to joke about eBay, that if Martians took over eBay, it would take like 6 months for the world to notice. That's what eventually what you want to get to. Or as Warren Buffett says, you know, build a company that idiots can run because eventually they will. So this is what you want. Basically a performance machine that idiots can run. Now as a leader, what is your real job? What's your role? Strictly speaking, there's only one book ever written that actually explains how to do this. It's a little old. It's written in 1982 by Andy Grove. It's quite famous and quite successful. And his definition of what your job is to maximize the output of an organization, your organization that you're responsible for, CEOs, everything, and a VP would be a part of the organization, and the organizations around you. So if you're a VPE, you actually are responsible for the performance of the product team too, or the marketing team, because you have influence there. So this is how you measure people, and you want to focus on the output, not the input. The old adage about not measuring motion and confusing that with progress, you're measuring only progress. And this is going to sound like a fancy and glamorous thing to do. Maybe people get excited about managing a whole large organization and being responsible for the output. But in practice, what you're going to learn today, hopefully, is that it's more about things like ordering smoothies, teaching your receptionist how to answer the phone properly, and serving as a $10 an hour task rabbit for your employees. So let's talk about that. So at first, when you start a company, everything's going to feel like a mess. And it really should. If you have too much process, too much predictability, you're probably not innovating fast enough and creatively enough. So it should feel like every day there's a new problem. And what you're doing is fundamentally triaging. So some things will look like a problem and they're actually a cold. They're just going to go away. So somebody's annoyed about this or that. That may be a cold and you shouldn't stress about it. You certainly shouldn't allocate a lot of your time to it. And some things are going to present themselves as colds. But just like in the emergency room, if they're not diagnosed properly, they actually can become fatal. So what I'm going to try to do is help give you frameworks for thinking about which things are colds and which things are potentially fatal. So one of the most important things I learned at Square is actually a concept of editing. And this is, I think, the best metaphor I've ever seen in like 14 years of running stuff of how to think about your job. It's natural. It's a natural metaphor, so it's easy to take with you every day. And actually, it's easy to transmit to each of your employees so that they can figure out whether they're editing or writing. It's a natural construct. You generally know when someone asks you to do something, am I more writing or am I more editing? So an editor is the best metaphor for your job, and we're going to talk about the specific things you're doing in editing. The first thing an editor does, and you've probably all had this experience in school, is you submit a paper to a TA, a draft to your friend. The first thing an editor does is they take out a red pen, or nowadays, you know, online, and they start striking things, basically eliminating things. The most important task of an editor is to simplify, 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 and that usually means omitting things. So that's your job, too, is to clarify and simplify for everybody on your team. The more you simplify, the better people will perform. People cannot understand and keep track of a complicated set of initiatives, so you've got to distill it down to one, two, or three things and use a framework that they can repeat without thinking about, they can repeat to their friends, they can repeat at night. Don't accept the excuse of complexity. A lot of people will tell you that, well, this is too challenging, this is too complicated. Well, yeah, I know other people simplify, but that's not for me. This is a complicated business. They're wrong. You can change the world in 140 characters. You can build the most important companies in history in a very simple to describe concept. You can market products in less than about 50 characters. There's no reason why you can't build your company the same way. So force yourself to simplify every initiative, every product, every marketing, everything you do, and basically take out that red and start eliminating stuff. Second thing is what editors do is they ask you clarifying questions. So when you present a paper to somebody, what do they usually do? They find some ambiguity somewhere, and they say, well, do you really mean this? Do you mean that? Do you have an example of this? That's what your job is. So you're in a meeting, and people are going to look to you. And the real thing you do is you actually ask a lot of questions. And they can be simple, basic questions like, should we try this 7 days a week or 6 days? They can be fundamental questions like, where's our competitive advantage here? We try to do this actually as investors too. Some investors will ask you a billion questions about a billion things, and they'll have you do diligence forever. We try to narrow down to what are the one, two, or three, four things that actually matter for this company and only focus on those things. So it allows us to be more decisive, and we can make decisions rapidly. It allows us not to distract you from your day job, which is actually building a company. And yet, I think we still get to the highest fidelity answer because we don't have all these extra extraneous pieces of details and data. Now, it's hard. It's something you have to practice. But when you're good at it, every step you eliminate, Andy Grove estimated that you can improve performance by 30 to 50%. The next thing you do is allocate resources. So the editing construct, this is what editors do all the time. They take editors from the Mideast and covering the Mideast, and they move them to Silicon Valley because Silicon Valley is now more interesting. Or they move them to a sports section because they want to compete on the basis of sports with other journals and other publications. So that can be top-down, where I take a bunch of allocated resources and people and say, we're now going over here, we're going to compete on this basis, and then next month, next quarter, next year, I'm like, well, that Middle East coverage is getting boring and bland, we don't want to do that anymore, let's go chase after something else. Or it can be bottom-up, just like journalists mostly come up with their own stories. The people who work with you generally should be coming up with their own initiatives. So a reporter will generally, who covers Google, come up with the interesting stories that they're hearing in ether and propose one or two to their editor for approval, but it's not like the editor saying, go cover Google and this is the angle I want. Once in a while they do that, but that's not the day, meat and potatoes of what a journalist does every day. Your goal over time is to actually use less red ink every day. So one way of measuring how well you're doing and communicating to your colleagues about what's important and what's not, why some things are important, some things are not, is how much red ink you're pulling out every day. And it's okay if you have a bad day and the red ink's all over the place, but it's not okay if the red ink next month is more than it was last month, the next quarter is more than this. So measure yourself of how much red ink you're creating. The other thing that's very important that actually isn't as intuitive to a lot of people is the job of an editor is to ensure a consistent voice. So if any of you read The Economist, you can tell that there's one consistent voice. You can pick up any article, any post in The Economist, and it feels like it was written by the same person. Ideally, your company should feel like on your website, on your PR release, on your packaging if it's a physical product, anywhere on your recruiting pages, should feel like it was written by one person. That's extremely difficult to do. And at first, you're going to be tempted to do that yourself, which is okay for a founder to do that, him or herself initially. Over time, you do not want to be doing all of the consistent voice editing by yourself. You want to train people so they can recognize the differences in voice. So if you see this website page, it looks very different than the recruiting page. You start asking questions, why is that? Is the reporting messed up? Is one of the leaders over here not really understanding the voice of the company? So you have to fix that over time. But you want to start with the objective of everything should feel exactly the same. It's quite difficult to practice. Almost every company has at least one piece of the organization that isn't exactly on the same voice. At Apple, which is under Steve's regime, which was notorious for getting this right, if you ask someone who worked at Apple, ask them about the internal tools about recruiting, do they really feel like Apple products? All of them will tell you no. So you're never 100%, but you definitely want to get as close to that as you can. The next complicated topic is delegating. So just like the other thing I like about the metaphor of editing is writers do most of the work in the world. Editors are not actually writing most of the content in any publication. So that's actually true of your company. You are not going to do most of the work. You shouldn't be doing most of the work. And the way you get out of doing most of the work is you actually delegate. Now, the problem with delegating is that actually you're responsible for everything. So as CEO, founder, there is no excuse. There's no, like, that's that department over there, this person over there screwed up. You're always responsible for every single thing, especially when things go wrong. So how do you both delegate but not abdicate? It's a pretty tricky challenge, and both are sins. Like, if you over-delegate and you abdicate, or you micromanage, those are both sins. So I'm going to give you a couple techniques for solving this. First, and this actually comes from High Output Management and Andy Grove, is what's known as task-relevant maturity. It's kind of a fancy phrase for basically, has this person ever done this before? It's really simple. Like, how mature is this person in doing something? And the more they've done the exact same task before, the more sort of rope you're going to give them, and the more they're trying something new, the more you're going to actually instruct them and consistently, constantly, regularly monitor. So that's kind of a basic concept, but it's worth keeping in the back of your brain. The interesting implication, and this is pretty radical, is that any executive, any CEO should not have one management style. Your management style actually needs to be dictated by your employee. So with one particular person, you may be very much a micromanager because they're quite low on this scale. And with another person, you may be delegating a lot because they're actually quite mature on this scale. So it's actually a good thing if you reference checks on somebody and half the people you call say they're a micromanager and the other half say they actually give me a lot of responsibility. That's actually that's a feature, not a bug. I didn't understand that at first at all. Like, I used to be befuddled when people would do reference checks on me and come back with this like complicated mosaic. And that basically finally figured out that maybe I was actually doing my job correctly. So then, of course, taught other people that this is the way to do it. A more nuanced answer, though, that I've sort of came up with is how do you make decisions and delegating versus doing it yourself? You don't want to do it yourself too often. So what I'll basically borrow from Peter, it's my first 2x2 matrix ever in my life, but he taught me something at least, is you basically sort your own level of conviction about a decision on a grid. You know, extremely high, extremely low. There's times when you know something's a mistake, and there's times where you wouldn't do it that way, but you have no real idea whether it's the right or wrong answer. And then there's a consequence dimension. There are things that if you make the wrong decision are actually catastrophic to your company, and you will fail. There are things that are pretty low impact that really, at the end of the day, aren't going to make a big difference, at least initially. So what I basically believe is that where there's low consequences and you have a low confidence in your own opinion, you should absolutely delegate. And delegate completely. Let people make mistakes and learn. On the other side, obviously, where the consequences are extremely dramatic and you have extremely high conviction that you're right, you actually can't let your junior colleague like make a mistake. You're ultimately responsible for that mistake, and if it's really important, you just can't allow that to happen. Now, the best way to do that is to actually explain your thinking, the why. It's easy to shortcut when you get busy explaining whys of the world, but it's very important to try. When I was at LinkedIn, I had a colleague who's quite talented, but occasionally would get annoyed if I didn't exactly agree with his opinion on something. And so I spent a lot of time trying to persuade him why I was making a decision a certain way. And his wild card, the card he would ultimately call out if I didn't quite persuade him, was he's like, okay, you're the boss. And that meant to me like I was burning a lot of social capital. Every time he said that, I knew I was like really creating a thin line. And that ultimately that was going to backfire if I did that too often. So you want to track the times that you're doing that. An example of this is Square, is one of my favorite people in the world, and my second hire, first marketing hire, had this program he wanted to run called Inner Square, which basically allowed people to give out swimmers is to get out 10 other squares to their college. Imagine a food truck outside, put like 10 squares on the counter, and people could just grab.
I might interrupt his story midway. You can listen to the rest of that story if you want. It's basically, he knew the guy had a bad idea. Because it wasn't going to make too much of an impact, he let that guy do it anyway, so he would learn the lesson that, you know, so that he knew in the future how to filter his ideas whenever those ideas came, because it was better for him to learn to do that and learn, as opposed for him to go in and basically just didactically say, this is what you're going to do as a manager. A lot of this stuff, like, is quite difficult. Management's quite hard, and I'm experiencing this. I've had limited management experience in my professional career before I started a startup. And managing in a startup is even harder because the pressure is high. It's a lot higher than in a normal job. You know, when every month you have a finance meeting and you look at your cash balance and say, right, we've only got so many months to go, everything is just hyper kind of intense. Which makes it exciting, but it also makes managing in that environment hard as well, because you usually managing in maybe a corporate environment or you know, elsewhere, you've got a lot more breadth and scope to let things run or let things, you know, people, you know, learn on their own pace. But if people aren't learning at the pace of your growth and the pace of your cash burn, then it can cause conflict. That's really good advice in there. I thought it was quite good. All right, hiring. So, hiring and management, and this also relates to culture because the people define your culture. One of the best, I think, writers on this management, hiring, dealing with people is a guy called Ben Horowitz. And a lot of his links are at the bottom there. And there's also a big long. He wrote a book called The Hard Thing About Hard Things, which is a great book. And then he's also got this How to Manage YouTube talk, which is, some of it is straight from his book, which is really good. Other bits he goes off on a tangent and talks about ancient history and stuff, so you can ignore that. The three big things about hiring, well, the first thing I'll preface with hiring into a startup is that you basically can't hire the people that you want. Like, if you would imagine a startup, you are totally invested in your idea, and you've probably put everything you have, or a lot of what you have, whether it's your time or your money or both, into it. So you think it's the best thing in the world, and then it's actually really hard when you go and talk to someone, you're trying to convince them to come on board, and all they basically come at you and basically say, well, if you can't give me all of the money that I want, then I'm not going to join. So the first thing is to basically hire for potential. So rather than hiring for seniority, you might want, like, you know, the ex-CMO of Google, but you're not going to get them. You need to hire for potential, and these guys talk about it a bit. I'll talk about them in a second. Then the other one is hire into the mission. You don't want to hire people who are, you know, who think it's going to be cool to work for a startup, who are looking for a career change that will be a bit easier than what they're currently doing. You know, they might be willing to take a pay cut because they don't want to work as hard as they're currently working, all that sort of stuff. Basically, just say hard no to any of those people, in my opinion, as soon as you hear it. Basically, if you can pitch them on the mission, the thing that you want to do, the reason why you exist, and the reason why you think it's important, and if they buy into that, then hire them immediately, because they'll work harder and longer than anyone else. Similar around what we were talking about at the start, where Reid Hoffman had that, you know, triangle of your career where you should work on something you're passionate about that's aligned with your interests, that has a market. You should try and find that kind of triangle of all that perfect storm around people that you hire who have the skills but also believe in the mission. So these guys is the founder of Pinterest, which you guys would have heard about. You guys use Pinterest? All right, I'm sure some of the off-campus guys do. So I'm not sure if there is an equivalent of Pinterest in China. If there isn't, you should definitely start it. So Pinterest is this huge social network based on pinning images and videos of homewares and fashion, pardon me, and a range of other things. You create boards. It's basically just like a photo board. Yeah. So he founded that, and it grew pretty fast. Like, It's another social network. A little bit like Lofter, a little bit like that. Yeah.
Yeah, I saw there maybe one. Another Chinese version.
Yeah, there's a Chinese version, yeah. Of course, this is just probably a Chinese version. And then there's these guys founded a company called Stripe, and they're a what's called payment gateway, so they take payments online. They made it very easy to do, and they're very successful. They're like a success. So these guys are talking about hiring.
Two of culture and team, and we have Ben Silverman, the founder of Pinterest, and John and Patrick Collison, the founders of Stripe. Founders that have obviously sort of some of the best in the world at thinking about culture and how they build teams. So there's three areas that we're going to cover today. One will just be sort of general thoughts on culture as a follow-up to the last lecture, and then we're really going to dig into what happens at the founding of these companies and building out the early team, and then how that changes and evolves as these guys have scaled their companies up to, you know, 100 plus, I don't even know how many people you have now, but quite a lot, very large organizations, and how you adapt these principles of culture. But to start off, I just want to ask a very open-ended question, which is, what are the core pieces of culture that you found to be most important in building out your companies?
Sure, what are the most important parts? Oh, it's on. Yeah, I mean, I think for us, like, we think about it on a few dimensions. Like, one is, like, who do we hire, and what do those people value? Two is, what do we do every day? Like, why do we do it? Three is, what do we choose to communicate? And then I think the fourth is what we choose to celebrate. I guess the converse of that is, like, what you choose to punish. But in general, I think running a company based on what you celebrate is more exciting than what you punish. But I think those four things kind of make up the bulk of it for us.
You've placed a large emphasis on, as Stripe has grown, and probably more than other companies, is transparency internally. And I think it's something that's been really valuable for Stripe, and also a little bit misunderstood. All the things people talk about, like, you know, hiring really great people or giving them a huge amount of leverage, transparency for us plays into that. We think that, you know, if you are aligned at a high level about what Stripe is doing, if everyone really believes in the mission, and then if everyone has really good access to information and kind of has a good picture of the current state of Stripe, then that gets you a huge amount of the way there in terms of working productively together, and it kind of forgives a lot of the other things that tend to break as you grow a startup. And so as we've grown, you know, we started off 2 people, we're now over 170 people, we've put a lot of thought into the tooling that goes around transparency, because, you know, at 170 people, there is so much information being produced that you can't just consume it all as a fire hose. And so how we, you know, use Slack, how we use email, things like that, we can go into it more later. But I think that's one of the core things that's helped us work well.
I think culture, to some degree, is basically kind of the resolution to a bandwidth problem, in the sense that, maybe when you start out working on something, you're sort of coding all the time, but you can't code all the things that you think the product might need or the company might need or whatever, and so you decide to work with more coders, right? And so, you know, the organization gets larger, and maybe in some idealized world, that I don't think this is actually true, but kind of ideally, you could be involved in every single decision, in every single sort of moment of the company, and everything that happens, but obviously you can't, or maybe you can at 2 people, but you certainly can't at even like 5 or 10, kind of that point comes very quickly, then by the time you're 50, it's completely hopeless. And so culture is kind of how you, kind of what the strands are that you sort of want to have, the invariants that you want to kind of maintain as you can get specifically involved in sort of fewer and fewer decisions over time. I think when you think about it that way, maybe it's kind of importance becomes sort of self-evident, right? Because, again, like, the fraction of things you can be involved in directly is, like, diminishing, I mean, almost exponentially, sort of assuming your headcount growth is sort of on a curve that looks like, you know, one of the great companies. That's super important. And it kind of, it manifests itself in a bunch of, you know, different ways. Like, for example, in hiring, I think a large part of the reason why maybe the first 10 people you hire, what kind of those decisions are so important, is because you're not just hiring those first 10 people, you're actually kind of hiring 100 people, because you should think of kind of each one of those people as bringing along sort of another 10 people with them, and sort of figuring out exactly what 90 people you would like those first 10 people to bring along is obviously, it's going to be quite consequential for your company. But really briefly, I think it's largely about sort of abstraction.
So one thing that a lot of speakers in this class have touched on is how hiring those first 10 employees, if you don't get that right, the company basically will never recover. But no one's talked about how to do that. So what have the three of you looked for when you've hired these initial employees to get the culture of the company right? How have you found them, and what have you looked for?
Sure. So I guess this answer is different for every company, and I'll say for us, it was very inductive. So I literally looked for people that I wanted to work with and that I thought were talented. I think I've read all these books about culture because when I don't know how to do something, I first go read things, and everyone has all these frameworks. And I think one big misconception that someone said once is that people think culture is like architecture, when it's a lot more like gardening. You plant some seeds and then you pull out weeds that aren't working and they sort of expand. So when we first hired people, we hired people that were like ourselves. And I often looked at like three or four different things that I really valued in people. I looked for people that worked hard and seemed high integrity and low ego. I looked for people that were creative, and that usually meant they were really curious. They had all these different interests. Some of our first employees are probably some of the quirkiest people I've ever met. They were engineers, but they also had all these crazy hobbies. Like one guy had made his own board game with this elaborate set of rules. Another guy was really into magic tricks, and he had coded not only like this magic trick on the iPhone, but he had shot the production video in the preview. And I think that quirkiness has actually been a little bit of a calling card, and we find that really creative, quirky people that are excited about many disciplines and are extraordinary at one tend to build really great products, and they tend to be great at collaborating. And the last thing is, we really look for people that just wanted to build something great, and they weren't arrogant about it, but they just felt like it'd be really cool to take a risk and build something bigger than themselves. And that, at the beginning, is very, very easy to select for. If you were in our situation, we had this horrible office, like nobody got paid. So there was no external reason other than being excited about building something to join. In fact, there was every reason not to. And that's something, looking back, I really, really value, because we always knew people were joining for the purest reasons. And in fact, we're willing to forgo other great job opportunities, market salary, clean office, good equipment, just for the chance to work. So to this day, I think a lot of those traits have been seeded and are embedded in the folks that we look at now.
The first 10 hires are really hard because, you're making these first 10 hires at a point where no one's heard of this company, no one really wants to work for it. You're just these like two weird people working on this weird idea.
Like their friends are telling them not to join. For our second employee, he was like, I think he accepted the offer, he was just about to, and his best friends like took him out the night before. It was like a full-on assault for why you should not join this company, why this is like ruining your life, basically. The guy subsequently continued to join, and actually one of those friends also now works at Stripe. This is what you're up against.
It's also hard because no batch of 10 people will have as great an influence on the company as those first 10 people. I think everyone's impression of recruiting is, you open LinkedIn, it's sort of like ordering off the dollar menu. You're just like, I want that one, that one, and that one. And now you have some hires. Whereas, at least for us, it was very much over a very long time period talking people we knew or friends of friends into joining. We didn't have, huge networks. Patrick and I were both in college at the time, so there were no people that we'd really worked with to draw on. And so a lot of those early Stripes were people we had heard of friends, and the other interesting thing they all had in common is that they were all sort of early in their career or undervalued in some way. Because when you think about it, if someone is a known spectacular quantity, then, you know, they're probably working in a job and very happy with that. And so we had to try and find people who were, you know, in the case of our designer that we hired, he was 18 and in high school and in Sweden at the time. In the case of our CDO, he was in college at the time. You know, a lot of these people, they were early on in their careers. And the only way we could, you know, you can relax one constraint. You can, you know, relax the fact that they're talented, or relax, you know, that it's apparent that they're talented. And we, you know, not consciously, but we relax the latter.
Yeah, I think sort of finding kind of the people who are, I guess you have to kind of think like a value investor, right? You're looking for the human capital that's significant to value by the market. You know, you probably shouldn't look to hire your brilliant friends at Facebook and Google or whatever, because they're already discovered. You know, if they're willing to join, that's great, but they're probably harder to convince. John, I spent a while yesterday afternoon sort of trying to figure out in retrospect what kind of traits our first 10 or so people had in common that we thought were significant. And, you know, in general, sort of in speaking about culture, you know, I sort of want to caveat everything we say with, you know, Paul Buchan, I think, said that sort of advice is, you know, a very limited experience, wildly over extrapolated. I think there's a lot of truth to that. But for our particular first 10 people, the things we sort of figured out that seemed to be important were they're all sort of very genuine and straight. I think that actually matters quite a lot, in that sort of they're people that that others want to work with, that they're people that others trust. They sort of have an intellectual honesty in how they approach problems and so forth. They were people who really liked getting things finished. There's a lot of people who are really excited about tons of things. Only a subset of those are actually excited about, like, completing things. You know, there's a lot of talk about, for example, hiring people, you know, off their GitHub resumes, whatever. I actually think that doesn't quite ring kind of correct to me, in the sense that that places a large premium on sort of lots of different things. I think it's actually a priori sort of much more interesting to you know, work with someone who has spent 2 years sort of really investing in going deep in a particular area. And then the third trait that they all seem to have in common is they just sort of cared a great deal. Like, it was offensive to them when something was just a little bit off. And it kind of, again, in hindsight, all these like crazy things we used to do that do in fact seem crazy, like we probably shouldn't have done them, but everyone was always like, well, was borderline insane instead of how much they cared about tiny details. Like, we used to, every single API request that ever generated an error went to all of our inboxes and phoned all of us, because it seemed terrible to like ever have an error that you know didn't go and sort of get a resolution from the user standpoint. Or we used to like copy everyone else on every outgoing email, and we'd like point out, you know, slight grammar or spelling mistakes to each other, because it'd be terrible to ever send an email with a spelling mistake. Anyway, those are the three traits we came up with. Anyway, genuine, caring a great deal, and so that was my second one.
The other one.
Sorry, I was saying, yes, completing things, like list of three items.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing to say, just don't think there's any wrong place to...
The rest of that video is quite interesting. Obviously, it's quite long, but I only watched that first bit. I love that, you know, completing things was one of the things he couldn't remember. Cool. So there's, yeah, lots of other resources you can investigate on there. And that links in with culture. So I like this quote. Culture gets thrown around a lot. And it seems like something that only companies with lots of money and resources and energy and time can worry about. Which is kind of true if you think about culture as being, you know, drinks on a Friday night, but that's not really what it is. And one of the guys from Stripe just said it in a similar way too, and Brian Chesky, one of the founders of Airbnb, it's simply a shared way of doing things with passion, and it's actually a way to transcend or insert yourself or the way that you and your founders would do something when you get so big that you can't be in every decision. That's what they say. Like, your culture should be a cohesive way of making decisions and building your business in a way that probably you would if you've got a good way of doing things. So culture, basically, it should align to your values, and it basically defines a place to work or a place where people would want to work even when you're losing. So there's a famous story about culture from Ben Horowitz. Actually told it about Andy Gove. So the guy was mentioning a book by a guy called Andy Gove. It's a classic management book. And he was Andy Gove, I believe, was the CEO at Go. It was a company in America. And this Ben Horowitz basically says he's met multiple, like more than like tens of employees from Go, and every single one of them says it was the best work experience of their entire life, which doesn't seem too exceptional, except when you look at the success of that company. Basically, it was a huge failure. They raised lots of money. They collapsed. Everything went wrong. Everybody lost all of their money. It was basically a waste of all of their time, but all of them said it was still the best place they've ever worked. And that was credited with the culture that he was able to develop. So it's basically, culture is, you know, everyone would want to work at the team that's at the place where the team is winning. You know, everyone wants to be there. Like, you know, you would probably, all of us would probably go and want to work at somewhere like Facebook right now or Google, because they're like the winners. What's really hard is to basically get someone to come and work at your company, which is either unknown, or stay at your company when you might be running out of money or your main customers are leaving or all of these different things that will happen to you when you build a company. Like, things go wrong. And so the thing that keeps people there is the culture. The great way to build it is to have a mission and then align your culture to the mission. And then you should have a hierarchy of, you know, the company first, then the team, then yourself. And try and hire into people who have that natural disposition towards a team focus as opposed to a personal focus or a self focus, which is quite hard. Now, this guy. So Brian Chesky wrote a good slightly rude article, blog post on culture. And that was actually when they'd raised $150 million in venture funding for Airbnb. And they were talking to one of their key investors, a guy called Peter Thiel, who's a famous VC. And they said, you know, they were presenting like financial numbers to him and all that sort of stuff. And they just said, all right, what's the main thing that you think we should be focusing on? And Peter Thiel said, just don't mess up the culture. And they said, oh, the culture, what do you mean? And he said, well, and they just raised $150 million. And he said, the main reason why I invested in you is because of the culture that you've developed at Airbnb. So don't screw that up. Which is pretty impressive.
Set the stage with a few slides and some comments, but the main stage is going to be with Brian when he comes up and talks about how he built the Airbnb culture. So
we'll watch the first 10 minutes of this, where he talks about this guy, the former CEO of Zappos. And then you can watch the rest with Brian if you want to, if you find it interesting. But he goes through some, you know, culture kind of frameworks and different things in the first 10 minutes.
You're here. I've been following the presentations. And so now you know how to get started. You built a team. You started to sort of build your product. It's off the ground. It's growing. People love it. You figured out how to do that. You figured out how to create a very special one-of-a-kind company with monopoly powers that's big, and the market that you're chasing after is slightly bigger than the paper airplane business, so you're good, right? So now what? So we're here to submit that actually culture is the thing that's going to be very, very important for you to be able to scale the business as well as your team. And hopefully after this talk, you'll be able to know what is culture, why does it matter, how to sort of create your core values, and think about elements that sort of fit together for the core values and the culture that create a high performance team and get some best practices for the culture. So what is culture? Anybody want to take a guess at how one should define this?
A set of values.
Yeah, that's good. Did you look that up on the, because you had a computer and internet connection, did you just look it up? So these are some definitions that you'll find in Webster's dictionary, but we're at Stanford. This is kind of a trick question. It's a CS class. Questions are never straightforward. The real question is, what is company culture going to be? You know, culture that we can generally talk about society, about groups, about places or things. Here we're talking about company culture. And so how do one define company culture? We can take the previous definition and modify it a little bit. And so this is a hint of how we may want to define company culture. Every day, blank and blank of each member of the team in pursuit of our company blank. And some people have filled these in with different sort of things. A, the first blank could be assumptions, beliefs, values. My favorite is core values. The second blank for the B blank, people have said behaviors. My favorite sort of answer to that is real action. How do you act? And in pursuit of goals, that's kind of weak. In pursuit of big and hairy, audacious goals, that's a little stronger. But a better definition is in pursuit of the mission. So now that sort of we have that definition, what do we do with it? And why does it matter? This is a quote from Gandhi: your beliefs become your thoughts become your words become your actions, and your actions become your habits, and your habits become your values, and your values become your destiny. If you don't have a good culture in the company, you can't pursue your destiny. What matters is it becomes the first principles that you sort of go back to when you make decisions. It becomes a way to align people on values that matter to the company. It provides a certain level of stability to fall back on, and it provides a level of trust that people can sort of trust each other with. It also gives you a list of things that you should be able to figure out what to do and what not to do. And what the more important thing about that is what not to do. And then finally, the other thing that is important is it allows you to retain the right employees. There are people in this world that are not going to be a fit for your company, but if you have good, strong culture and good, strong core values, you'll know who you want to retain and who you do not want to retain. And if you take the first words, first letter of those, it happens to help you move faster. Another reason, you're thinking, that's like all mushy stuff. This is actually more scientific stuff. So here are indices from 1997 to 2003 of stock market index of companies in the S&P 500, in the Russell 3000, and then for the Fortune 100 best companies to work for. They survey all these companies out there, and they picked out companies that they believe are the best companies to work for, and the stock market returns of those companies happen to be 11.08%, which is almost twice that of the other two indices. And so there's real power in companies that treat their employees well, where there's a lot of trust and where there's a lot of strong culture. So how do you sort of create a set of values and sort of define the culture, et cetera? Get asked that a lot. You gotta start with the leader of the company, the founder, and sort of ask yourself, what are the personal values that are most important to you? What are those things that are most important to the business? Who are the types of people you like working with, and what are their values? And through that, you sort of distill together what a set of values are. Then think about all the people that you've never liked working with. What values do they have? Think of that, the opposite of that, and maybe those should be considered values for your company. And finally, remember, the values have to support your mission. And if it doesn't support your mission, you're missing something. And then the last final checks are, they have to be credible and they have to be uniquely tied to your mission. So at Zappos, in terms of uniquely applied to the mission, we were focused on creating a culture that was going to provide great customer service. So the first core value we had was to deliver wow through service. We were very specific that we wanted to deliver great customer service and it was going to be a wow experience. And then below that, we wanted to sort of add a paragraph supporting that, talking about exactly what we mean by that, want to support them, deliver WoW through service, and support people such as our employees, our customers, and our brand partners, and our investors. On terms of the opposite thing, we generally didn't like working with arrogant people. So one of our core values at Zappos was to be humble. So those are two examples where we sort of created core values in a way that sort of became credible and uniquely tied to our mission. So you go through this process, you come up with a few core values. These might be some of them, whether it's honesty, integrity, service, teamwork, and it might be a list of, you might start with 3, you might end up with a list of 10, you might list of 30. It's a good start. And when Zappos went through this process, we started with, like, you know, asked all the employees at the time what core values they want to identify with. We came up with 37. We sort of whittled that down to about 10. And it took a year to do this. That's a long time, and you might want to ask why. Well, if you just come up with the word honesty, I mean, give me a break. Everybody wants the culture to be honest. No, nobody's going to say, I want to be lied to every day. Service, what do you mean by service? There's got to be a lot more depth in this than that. And everybody talks about teamwork, but there's a difference in level of teamwork that you see in an intramural sports team as versus a baseball team. And so how do you sort of dive deeper into teamwork? What are the things that don't work for a team? A lot of it has to do with communications. A lot of it has to do with things that people have studied. And you might want to go deeper into that. At Zappos, we thought about, well, there are a lot of smart people in this room. When they're fighting with each other and trying to figure out who's right and who's not, it's probably not the best use of time. And we want everybody to sort of riff off each other and help each other make any idea better. The result is that the company gets a better idea, not that any individual person is right. So we wanted to instill this idea that it's company first, then your department, then your team, then yourself. And how do you do that? You can go a level deeper in that. There's a great sort of element of high-performing teams that I really like, which is this pyramid that was created by Patrick Lencioni, and he wrote this book, The 5 Dysfunctions of a Team. And the reason this is interesting, he talks about the breakdowns of a team. First of all, a lot of teams break down because they don't have any trust. Then, even if you had trust, why do you need trust? Well, then if you have trust, you can actually have debates and conflict and get to the right answer. If you don't have conflict and debate, people are just, it's the blind leading the blind. How do you know you actually got to the right answer before you sort of commit to something? So people are not actually willing to commit. They're afraid of committing. And so let's say you get to the next level and you are actually able to commit. Well, what goes wrong then? It's usually because people are not held accountable to things that they committed to. And if people are not held accountable to the things that they've committed to, then they can't get results. And I would submit to you, if you think about the company as a black box and results, whether it's financial, whether you produce a great product or anything like that as the output, one of the major inputs is the culture of the company. So some other best practices we're going to actually talk about during Q&A, because I think this is going to blend into the conversation, is that you want to incorporate your mission into values. We've talked about that. Performance. You got to think harder, deeper, longer about your values than you might initially think you need to do. One of the things that I think a lot of companies don't actually do is they interview for technical fit or skill fit or competency in that realm, but they don't actually interview for the culture fit and whether someone will actually believe and follow the mission. I think that's a big, big no-no. Like, I think you can have the smartest engineer in the world, but if they don't believe in your mission, they're not going to pour their heart and soul into it. And that's one of the things that where if you actually sort of start thinking about culture from the interview process to performance reviews to making sure that it's a daily habit, you'll get a lot further with making a great culture. The final point on making a daily habit, I think culture, just like customer service or fitness, is like motherhood and apple pie. Everybody wants to provide great customer service. Every company wants to have a great culture. What they fail to do is make it a daily habit. You just can't be fit if you don't do it as a daily habit. Eventually you get out of shape, then you get fat, and then you're like, oh, I gotta go on a crash diet to sort of get back into shape. That doesn't quite work. And the same is true with something like culture. So I think we checked all of these off, so we can go into Q&A with Brian.
Cool. And then, yeah, if you're interested in the Airbnb story, I'd watch the rest of that. So it sounds like culture's kind of opaque. One of the great examples I've heard is you have, like, you instill moments that reinforce your culture or your values, in your culture. So an example of that is A16Z, Andreessen Horowitz, the venture capital firm, the guy that will listen to Mark Andreessen at the end of the session. It's his venture fund. And basically, VCs are infamous for just treating entrepreneurs like shit. Like, they just don't treat them with a lot of respect. And so they said, because they're both entrepreneurs, they're like, well, we're not going to do it like that. Our culture is going to be respect the founder, because they're under a lot of pressure and we really need them to be, you know, we want to have respect for them because we do. So basically they said, any person from their organization who has a meeting with a founder, if you're 1 minute, every minute that you're late to a meeting with them, we'll charge you $10. So if you're 10 minutes late, that's $100 that they on the spot have to give to the founder. And they, like, even that's like analysts, anybody junior, like all the way up to like managing directors or partners who join the venture fund. And apparently it's just made these people in that industry, because they're all used to being gods, just stand back. And it's specifically designed to make them take a step back and go, holy crap, that's pretty extreme. So that they can reinforce one of their core values, which is we respect the founders. Like, that's one of the core. So if you've got those core key, like, planks of your culture around your values, you try and build some sort of repetitive interaction around that value that reinforces it every day. Kind of like what he was saying, you know, what's the habit? So you build something like that. You know, it can be a positive, obviously, as well as a fine. Like, that's a negative. But his opinion is you build it around those things so that they're just kind of constantly almost automated in the background and happening. All right, cool. Let's talk about funding. So sooner or later, almost every business will need capital, some kind of capital. There's two kinds of capital or cash that you can get as a business. Oh yeah, before I say that, it's very rare that businesses to be funded to scale via cash flow, but what that means is the money that you make is enough and provides you enough surplus to, say, hire the next set of people that need to grow the business. Usually, you have to borrow the money or give a chunk of your company away, get some money to grow. The reason why, those are the two types of funding. There's equity funding and there's debt funding. So you can borrow money from a bank, or you can borrow money from someone and say, I'll pay it back later. Or you can get equity funding, where just they'll give you cash and you have to give up a chunk of your company. The reason why startups almost exclusively go with equity funding, so they have to give a chunk of the company up, is because they're so high risk. So you can't go to a bank and say, can I have money for my startup business? Because they're so risky, the banks just go, probably not. Whereas if you're buying a property, they'd be like, well, you know, even if you go bankrupt, I can probably sell it for 80% of the value of the price that you bought it for, and I'm probably only going to lend you that much money anyway, so the risk is very, very low. Or startups don't work like that. So there are two resources I'd point to. There's Andreessen Horowitz, A16Z. They've got an extensive advice how-to section. There is so much content around funding, that sort of stuff, you can get to if you're interested or when you get to this point. The other one is First Round Review. They've got a lot of stuff on startups and funding as well. They're another, First Round is another VC fund. So funding is actually pretty simple. There's lots of terms that get thrown around startup funding, but it's essentially, equity funding is essentially an exchange. So you offer a portion of your company for money, and it happens at different rates. So you give up a certain chunk of the company on average at different stages of your company's life. But the basic principle is the same. So here's an example. So you go out to market, out to the investor market, which basically is a bunch of people that you either know or you can get introduced to, and you say, look, our company, we think, is worth $8 million right now. And that's kind of like when you're selling a house. You say, I reckon this house is worth X, and you put it on the market. And you say that's 100% of that company at that point, this is the top, is owned by either you or your founders at that point, or whoever owns it, you know, which for you guys, it would be you, if you started it, you and your founders typically. And then you basically, at that $8 million, you say, look, we want to raise $2 million because the financial modeling we've done says if we raise $2 million now, we can get this many customers and have this much traction. And so if we raise $2 million, we're going to give you 20% of the company for $2 million. And that means 20% will be owned by any of the new investors or the new investor that comes on board, and 80% will be retained by the founders. So once you get that money in, if you go down to the next line, 20% is owned by the new investors, you own 80%. At the bottom is where you end up. And the bottom is the total value of the company, what's called post-money, as in when you get the money in. Once you get the money in, your company was worth $8 million at the start, but now you've got $2 million in the bank. So it's 8 plus 2. So now your company's worth $10 million. Essentially, that's why they purchased 20% of the company for $2 million. Even though you started at an $8 million valuation, you said, look, when you give us the money, we're worth $8 million now. Once you give us the money, we'll be worth 10. You're buying in at that rate, which means, $2 million will buy you 20% of the company at post-money valuation of $10 million. And then 100% of the company is then owned by all the shareholders, including the new guys, and they all come in. And usually at that point, they'll go into your board and all that sort of stuff. You'll have to have a board at that point. What will happen is, if you actually go out and do this, is that you go to market and say, look, we want a pre-money valuation of $8 million. And an investor might say, and then that gives you 20% of the company. An investor might say, yeah, I'll give you $2 million, but I think your company's worth $5 million, not $8 million. And then you negotiate. And the implication of that is they might still want to give you the $2 million, but essentially they're trying to buy more of your company. So they might end up with 30% of your company then, not 20%. Or, when we raised our initial funding round, it was, $1.5 million was our valuation, and we were raising $500,000. So that was, they got 30%, or not quite 30%, 25%. So that's the basic proposition. So whenever anybody talks about pre-money and post-money valuation, that's what they mean. There's lots of complicated other crap that goes on in here. That's in the context of cash. There's also what's called a convertible note, and we'll talk about that on the next section. So these are the different funding stages that you'll see, and I'll go through some examples of some media companies that have raised money so you can see this in action, like the real examples. Funding occurs in rounds, so they call them funding rounds. And a round is basically a period of time, basically when you say, look, we're going to raise some money now. That round could last 6 months. It could last 5 minutes. It doesn't really matter. It's basically the time when you go out to market with your investor memo and say, hey, I'm raising money. Try and talk to as many people as possible. Drum up some interest. You might have two or three parties competing. The most important thing in raising money is competitive dynamics. Getting more people at the table will mean that you'll hold your valuation. More investors. If you end up with just one investor and you can't bluff your way through that scenario, you'll end up with a shitty valuation and you'll get crunched. You need competitive dynamics in the moment, like with any deal, really. So at the start, there's what's called seed, and this is sort of lower seed. This is where you might fund the business. You might have taken a loan from the bank against a car or a house that you own to do that. It can be, it could be more than this, but typically it might be, $10 to $500,000. If you do it with friends and family, it could be up. You might give them equity in the company. Probably not a good idea, but you might have done that. It's better to take it as a loan. Then there's the next stage, which is more seed from investors, and that's typically $1 to $3 million. Could be lower. Typically not much higher than that. And that's where people called angel investors come in. They're people who are really interested in working with entrepreneurs, high net worth individuals, so people who are quite rich, but can't afford to take really large investment chunks at the 2 to 5 million mark. And then some VC firms actually come in here, and typically you'll have to give up between 20 and 30% of the company. You will never give up, or you should never give up, or good investors would never take more than 30%. Because if they do that, it basically demotivates the founding team. Because if you've got to give up so much of your company just to keep it alive, and then you think, well, into the future this might be worth this, but you know, I'll probably have to give some to my initial employees as well, and then I might have more funding rounds. By the end of it, you mightn't have anything left. So it kind of is a demotivating factor. So they don't want to take too much, but they need to take enough so that's valuable. It's usually 20 to 30%. And then if you imagine you're taking that much money, your valuations at that point are probably somewhere between 5 and 10 million, just based on that basic calculation we went through. The next is what's called Series A. So it goes from seed, and then it starts on a series basis. So Series A, $2 to $5 million typically, and that's when the value, the amount that they take starts to go down to 10 to 20%. And typically only VC firms or bigger companies will do that. So big companies also have venture investment arms and they invest in startups when they get to this point. They never really invest further down. They usually invest from Series A up, although there are exceptions. Some high net worths do play in there, but not many. Oh, yeah, sorry, before I go into that, back to the seed round. These are equity investments, so they take a chunk of your company. Sometimes angel investors will actually go, yeah, I reckon you're pretty talented, you're pretty committed, you haven't got a business model yet. I'll give you some money, say seed, a round of money, and then they take what's called a convertible note. A convertible note basically means, look, is basically them saying, you need money to figure this out, to find your business model. You and I don't really know what the valuation is going to be, but I'll give you the money anyway, and then when we get to the next round, when you do get a valuation, I'll just accept whatever that is. So they don't have to, you don't have to do the valuation dance at that point. That it sometimes happens. I'm actually having a conversation with an overseas investor at the moment specifically around that, and she's offered to have a convertible note or equity, but we just went with equity because we're more in the Series A mark. But she's used to working with startups that are down the bottom that where she has to give, you know, convertible notes and that sort of stuff. So then you go from Series A, Series B, that's when it starts to get, you know, pretty chunky amounts of money, 20 to 30 million, sometimes even more, from the same group, 10 to 20%. Sometimes that could be lower, actually, and then you go to Series C to E, and then it could just be equity, whatever it is, 50 million plus, like you, there's huge amounts of money in there. And then that's usually a lower amount of percentage as well, so 2 to 10%, or they might just purchase the whole company outright at that point. Or when you get to that point, you might also be thinking about listing and going IPO, what's called IPO. So big tech companies obviously do that quite a lot. Here are some examples of some media companies, some of the most prominent media companies that have done this. And so you can see, so Vox Media, huge company now. It's like, it's they started before 2008. They started as a blog or a collection of blogs around SB Nation, the site SB Nation. They then branched out into a range of other sites. They started a technology platform. They're huge now. So you can see some weird stuff going on in there, but you can see that undisclosed amount at the bottom is probably their first seed round. Then there was Series A at 5 million. They took another, so you could call that Series B, but it was just a venture round. Series C, 10 million. Series D, 30 million. See how it starts to go up pretty quickly. Series E, they took $40 million, $46 million at a valuation of 380. So at that valuation, whoever, General Atlantic, obviously bought around about 10% of the company. And then they went Series F, which is kind of ridiculous, but it was from NBC for $200 million, and we have no idea how much that was for. But they took a chunk of the company, and that was, you know, so that's over a, it's actually not that long, like 8 or 9 years. So it does happen. Another example is BuzzFeed, which we all know about. So they started with a Series A of $3.5 million in 2008, around the same time. And you can just see the scale and the pace of equity funding. Now, it's important to remember that raising money doesn't mean that you're winning. There's lots of companies out there that are really good at raising money from investors, but aren't really good at building sustainable businesses underneath them. So it's important to remember that, like, BuzzFeed hasn't like solved the digital journalism problem by any stretch of the imagination. They're still making money. They've got a huge audience, but it's not like they are like a messiah. It will say like the model. But what it does show you is that there are viable paths for growth for media, digital media startups, because all of these brands that we now know about, like BuzzFeed, started at a Series A round, and before that there would have been a seed round as well. So 3.5, 8 million for Series B. You know, usually what happens is you see that new enterprise associates, or, you know, as an example, they'll go in on one round and then they'll usually be the one that coming up behind it for the next round, and they'll put more money in over time. But that's a huge amount of money, like $200 million to raise. Another one which isn't as huge is Business Insider. Have you guys heard of Business Insider? They're a global digital media company focused on business. They've got different arms in different markets. They're here in Australia. They've got quite high reach in Australia, actually. And they started on a $900,000 seed round on a very, very good valuation by the look of it. So they were valued at $6 million and they managed to raise $900,000. And at that point, they would probably just have had an MVP, probably just a WordPress blog. So another example of this is Mashable. Have you guys heard of Mashable or TechCrunch? They're two other examples. They started as technology blogs, WordPress blogs. Now they've got a similar... Pardon me, a similar valuation and a similar kind of trajectory. So these guys raised $25 million last year. And then Mike, sorry about the text. Mike is a, it's weird, going on there, is a millennial-focused media digital media company. And they started, so they've raised half of the amount of Business Insider, but they've been going for less than half the time, so 3 years. Started at a $1.8 million seed round as just a pure digital media company, and their latest round was a Series B, $17 million. It's quite impressive, really. Cool. So this video is the last one we'll show, and then we'll stop. So Marc Andreessen is one of the most influential people in digital, and he runs that venture capital firm I was talking about before. Ron Conway, I think, actually works for him. And then this guy, Parker Conrad, is actually an entrepreneur. So he's on the other side and he talks a little bit about what it's like to raise money from investors. We might watch a little bit of this and then you can watch more of it if you're interested. But they give really good insights around what makes investors want to give money to entrepreneurs and what entrepreneurs do to try and get money out of investors. Start with there
we go. And then we invest in a variety of different business models, consumer, enterprise, and a bunch of other variations. So there are kind of fine-grained answers, you know, that we could get into if there are specific questions. Two general concepts that I would share. So one is the venture capital business. It's 100% a game of outliers. It's extreme exceptions. Right, so the conventional statistics are, you know, on the order of 4,000 venture fundable companies a year that want to raise venture capital. About 200 of those will get funded by what's considered a top tier VC. About 15 of those will someday get to $100 million in revenue. And those 15 from that year will generate something on the order of 97% of all the returns for the entire category of venture capital in that year. And so venture capital is such an extreme feast or famine business. You're either in one of the 15 or you're not, or you're in one of the 200 or you're not. And so the big thing that you're just looking for, no matter, you know, which sort of particular kind of criteria we talk about, they all have a characteristic of you're looking for the extreme outlier. The other thing I'd highlight that we think about a lot internally is we have this concept, invest in strength versus lack of weakness. And at first that sounds obvious, but it's actually fairly subtle. Which is sort of the default way to do venture capital is to kind of check boxes, right? So, you know, really good founder, really good idea, you know, really good, you know, products, really good initial customers, check, 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 okay, this is reasonable, I'll put money in it. But what you find with those sort of checkbox deals, and they get done all the time, what you find is they often don't have something that really makes them really remarkable and special, right? They don't have an extreme strength that makes them an outlier. On the other side of that, the companies that have the really extreme strengths often have serious flaws. So one of the cautionary lessons of venture capital is if you don't invest on the basis of serious flaws, you don't invest in most of the big winners. So we could go through example after example after example of that. But that would have ruled out almost all the big winners over time. So at least what we aspire to do is to invest in the startups that have a really, really extreme strength along an important dimension, and then be willing to tolerate some other set of weaknesses.
Ryan, we got your slide up.
Okay, I don't want to overdwell on the slide, but when you first meet an investor, you've got to be able to say in one compelling sentence that you should practice like crazy what your product does, so that the investor that you're talking to immediately can picture the product in their own mind. Probably 25% of the entrepreneurs I talk to today still, after the first sentence, I don't know what they do. And as I get older and less patient, I say, back up, I don't even know what you do yet. So try and get that perfect. And then I want to skip to the second column. You have to be decisive. The only way to make progress is make decisions. Procrastination is the devil in startups. So no matter what you do, you got to keep that ship moving. If it's decisions to hire, decisions to fire, you got to make those quickly. All about building a great team. Once you have a great product, then it's all about execution and building a great team.
Parker, could you talk about your seed round and how that went and what you wish you had done differently as a fundraising money?
Sure. So actually, I think my seed round, most of the stuff with my current company felt like, from a fundraising perspective, felt like it came together relatively quickly. But actually, one of the experiences that I had, I started a company before this that I was at for about 6 years, and my co-founder and I pitched almost every VC firm in Silicon Valley. I mean, we literally went to like 60 different firms, and they all told us no. And we were constantly trying to figure out, you know, how should we adjust our pitch, and how should we do the slides differently, and how do we tweak the story, and that sort of thing. And at one point, there was this sort of key insight that someone gave me when I was pitching, actually someone at Coastal Ventures, this VC said, guys, you know, he was looking for some very particular kind of analysis that we didn't have on hand. And he was like, guys, you don't get it. He was like, you know, if you guys were the Twitter guys, you guys could come in and you could just be like, and like, you know, put whatever up here, and like, we would invest in you, but like, you guys aren't the Twitter guys, so you need to make this really easy and have like all this stuff ready for us and all this kind of stuff. And I took like the exactly opposite lesson of what he, I think, wanted me to take away from that with, which was like, geez, like, I should really just figure out a way to be the Twitter guys. And like, that's the way to do this. So actually, like, one of the reasons I started my current company, or one of the things I found very attractive about Zenefits, is as I was thinking about it, it seemed like a business. I was so frustrated from this experience of having tried, you know, for like 2 years to raise money from VCs, and then sort of decided, like, to hell with it, you can't count on there being capital available to you. The business that I started seemed like one that, like actually just maybe I could do it without raising money at all. Like, there might be a path to kind of, you know, there was enough cash flow, it seemed compelling enough that I could, like, do that. And it turns out that those are exactly the kinds of businesses that investors love to invest in. And it made it incredibly easy. So I actually think, like, I mean, Sam's very kind and said I was an expert fundraising. The reality is I don't actually even think I'm very good at fundraising. It's probably something I'm, like, less good at than you know, sort of other parts of my job. But I think if you can build a business that's, you know, where everything is, like, moving in the right direction, if you can, like, be the Twitter guys, like, nothing else matters. And if you can't, like, you know, be the Twitter guys, it's very hard for anything else to make a difference, for things to kind of come together for you.
Why did that VC say be like the Twitter guys when the fail whale dominated the site for 2 years?
Because
right, anyway.
It worked.
Yeah. The other point I want to make is bootstrap as long as you possibly can. I met with one of the best founders in tech who's starting a new company, and I said to her, well, what are you going to raise money? I might not. And I go, that is awesome. You'll never forget the bootstrap.
So I was actually going to close on this, but I'm just going to accelerate it, because Parker, I think, just gave you the most important thing you'll ever hear, which is what I was also going to say, which is, so the number one piece of advice that I've ever read and that I tell people on these kinds of topics is always, it's from the comedian Steve Martin, who I think is an absolute genius, wrote a great book on his startup career, which obviously was very successful. The book's called Born Standing Up, and he literally, it's a short little book that describes how he became Steve Martin. And the heart of the book is, he says, you know, what's the key to success? He says, the key to success is be so good they can't ignore you. Right? And so in a sense, like all this, we're going to have this entire conversation, and I'm sure we'll keep having it about how to raise money, but in a sense, it's all kind of beside the point. Because if you do what Parker's done and you build a business that is going to be a gigantic success, then investors are throwing money at you. And if you come in, you know, with a theory and a plan and no data, and you're just one of, you know, the next thousand, it's going to be far, far harder to raise money. So that's the positive way to put it, is kind of be so good they can't ignore you. In other words, you're almost always better off making your business better than you are making your pitch better. The other thing, that's the positive way of looking at it. The negative way of looking at it, or the cautionary lesson, is that, and this gets me in trouble every single time I say it, but I'm on a ton of flu medication, so I'm going to go ahead and just let it rip. Raising venture capital is the easiest thing a startup founder is ever going to do. As compared to recruiting engineers in particular, as compared to recruiting engineer number 20, it's far harder than raising venture capital. Selling to enterprise customers is harder. Getting viral growth going on a consumer business is harder. Getting advertising revenue is harder. Almost everything you'll ever do is harder than raising venture capital. And so I think Parker is exactly right. If you get in a situation in which raising the money is hard, it's probably not hard compared to all the other stuff that's about to follow. And it's very important to bear that in mind. It's often said raising money is not actually a success. It's not actually a milestone for a company, and I think that's true, and I think that's the underlying reason. It puts you in a position to be able to do all the other harder things.
Related to that, what do you guys wish founders did differently when raising money? And specifically, Mark, you mentioned this relationship between money and risk, how that applies here, so maybe we can start with that.
Yeah, so the single biggest thing that people are just missing, and I think it's all of our faults, we're all not talking about it enough, but I think the single biggest thing entrepreneurs are missing, both on fundraising and how they run their companies, is the relationship between risk and cash. So the relationship between risk and raising cash, and then the relationship with risk and spending cash. So I've always been a fan of something that Andy Ratcliffe taught me years ago, which he calls it the onion theory of risk, which basically is, you can think about a startup like on day one as having every conceivable kind of risk, right? And you can basically just make a list of the risks. And so you've got, you know, founding team risk, you know, are the founders going to be able to work together? Do you have the right founders? You're going to have product risk. You know, can you build a product? You'll have technical risk, right, which is maybe you need a machine learning breakthrough or something to make it work. Are you going to be able to do that? You'll have, you know, launch risk. Will the launch go well? You'll have, you know, market acceptance risk. You'll have revenue risk. A big risk you get into in a lot of businesses that have a sales force is, can you actually sell the product for enough money to actually pay for the cost of sale? So you have cost of sale risk. If you're a consumer product, you'll have viral growth risk. Will you get the thing of viral growth? And so, a startup at the very beginning is basically just this long list of risks, right? And then the way that I always think about running a startup is also the way I think about raising money, which is it's a process of peeling away layers of risk as you go, right? And so you raise seed money in order to peel away the first two or three risks, right? The founding team risk, the product risk, maybe the initial launch risk. You raise the A round to peel away the next level of the product risk. Maybe you peel away some recruiting risk as you get your full engineering team built. Maybe you peel away some customer risk because you get your first 5 beta customers. Right, and so basically the way to think about it is you're peeling away risk as you go. You're peeling away risk by achieving milestones. And then as you achieve milestones, you're both making progress in your business and you're justifying raising more capital. Right, and so you come in and you pitch somebody like us and you say you're raising a B round. You know, the best way to do that with us is you say, okay, I raised a C round, I achieved these milestones, I eliminated these risks. I raised the A round, I achieved these milestones, I eliminated these risks. Now I'm going to raise a B round. Here are my milestones, here are my risks. And then by the time I go to raise a seed round, here's the state that I'll be in. And then you calibrate the amount of money that you raise and spend to the risks that you're pulling out of the business. And I go through all this, in a sense this sounds kind of obvious, but I go through all this because it's a systematic way to think about how the money gets raised and deployed as compared to so much of what's happening, especially these days, which is just, oh my God, let me go raise as much money as I can, let me go build the fancy offices, let me go hire as many people as I can, and just kind of hope for the best.
I'm going to be tactical. For sure, don't ask people to sign an NDA. We rarely get asked anymore because most founders have figured out that if you ask somebody for an NDA at the front end of the relationship, you're basically saying, I don't trust you. So the relationship between investors and founders involves lots of trust. The biggest mistake that I see by far is not getting things in writing. You know, my advice on the fundraising process is do it as quickly and efficiently as you possibly can. Don't obsess over it. For some reason, founders get their ego involved in fundraising where it's a personal victory. It is the tiniest step on the way, as Mark said, and it's the most fundamental. Hurry up and get it over with. But in the process, when somebody makes a commitment to you, you get in your car and you type an email to them that confirms what they just said to you. Because a lot of investors have very short memories, and they forget that they committed to you that they were going to finance, or they forget what the valuation was, or that they were going to find a co-investor. You can get rid of all that controversy just by putting it in writing, and when they try and get out of it, you just resend the email and say, excuse me. And hopefully they reply to that email anyway. So get it in writing. In meetings, take notes and follow up on what's important.
I want to talk a little bit more about the tactics here. Just how does the process go? Can people email you guys directly? Do they need to get an introduction? How many meetings does it take for you to make a decision? How do you figure out what the right terms are? When can a founder ask you for a check?
You wanna?
That was like six questions.
That's a lot.
Yeah, okay, good.
It's the process.
Why don't you describe? Because you'll describe seed, and then I'll describe.
Yeah. So SB Angel, invests in seed stage startups. So we like to be the very first investor. We normally invest today in a round that's $1 million to $2 million. It used to only be $1 million. So if we invest $250K, that means there's five or six other investors in that syndicate. SB Angel has now a staff of 13 people. I do no due diligence anymore. I am not a picker anymore. I just help on major projects for the portfolio companies that are starting to mature. But we have a whole team that processes. We at SB Angel end up investing in one company for every 30 that we look at, and we end up investing in about one a week. I think what's interesting is we don't really take anything over the transom. Our network is so huge now that we basically just take leads from our own network. We evaluate the opportunity, which means you have to send in a really great short executive summary. And if we like that, we actually vote, although I'm not in this meeting anymore, but the group actually votes on, do we make a phone call? That's how important time is in this process. And if enough of the team at SB thinks it's interesting, then they appoint a person to make a phone call to that founder, usually somebody on our team who has domain experience. If the phone call goes well, bingo, we want to meet you. If SB Angel asks you for a meeting, we are well on our way to investing. If that meeting goes well, we'll do some background checks, backdoor background checks, get a good feeling about the company, the market that they're going after, and then make the commitment to invest, and then start helping get other value-add investors to be part of the syndicate. Because if we're going to have an equal workload, we want the other investors in this company to be great angel investors as well.
So I'll talk a little bit about the venture stage, kind of the Series A stage, that follows. So to start with, I think it's fair to say at this point that all the top tier venture capitalists, pretty much only invest in two kinds of companies at the Series A stage. One is if they have previously raised a seed round. And so it's almost always the case when we're doing a Series A investment that the company has $1 million or $2 million of seed financing, you know, from Ron and folks that he likes to work with. Almost always, by the way, Ron, just to be clear, and folks he likes to work with. So first, either they have a seed round. So if you're going to raise Series A, the first thing to do is raise seed because that's generally the way the progression works at this point. Every once in a while, we'll go straight to A on a company that hasn't raised a seed round. Really, the only times, though, that happens are when it's a founder who has been a successful founder in the past and is almost certainly somebody we've worked with in the past. So we have an announcement. We just did one of these. We'll announce in a few weeks where it's a founder who I was an angel investor. Actually, I think Ron was also in the team's company in, like, 2006. And then the company did its thing and then ultimately was acquired by another big company. And then that team now is starting their new thing. So in that case, we're just going to jump it straight to an A because they're so well known, they have a plan all lined up for it. But you know, that's the exception. It's almost always preceded by a seed round. The other thing is, I guess I mentioned this already, but we get, similar to what Ron said, we get 2,000 referrals a year through our referral network. A very large percentage of those are referrals through the seed investors, and so by far the best way to get the best introductions to the A stage venture firms is to work through the seed investors, or to work through something like Y Combinator.
Speaking about terms, what terms should founders care most about, and how should founders care?
Let's turn that off. it's pretty interesting what they talk about in the rest of that. So if you are interested in that sort of funding stage, or if you ever get to that point, come back to these resources, because it's sort of a mysterious world until you start unpacking it, and then it becomes totally obvious. All right, I might stop.